Get me in the audio. What's going on?
Yeah, the audio. Not working.
Yeah. Are you on the live stream? I think it's working on the live stream. It's my built-in microphone. Whoops.
Now we invested nearly 30-40,000 euro on the dies for the for the what they call the shell. Now we have found the easier way to do it. Now we're reinvesting to make new cast. And when this is done, we do the same. Don't forget, you if you're thinking of setting up manufacturing and you want to be connected with the Keshe Foundation, get in touch with this, what do you call it, manufacturers of Keshe Foundation. We give you every support. We are the only organization in the world who is not afraid of collaboration to produce more. You're not a competition. The more you produce, the cheaper prices you produce, the faster the technology will be accepted worldwide. Never happened before. I heard someone saying that I'm going to produce so much Keshe Foundation magra power so cheap that I'm going to make Keshe Foundation bankrupt. Please do, because that's our purpose, to let the humanity out. And this is one of the reasons we moved in China, that we compete on the same legs worldwide. If the competition tries to go under price, it'll be the same for everybody else.
Mr. Keshe, we're getting a lot of static on your mic. Are you just away from your normal position?
I'm sitting maybe on the line of the speakers. Sometimes when I'm on the line of the speakers, you get this. So what it is, these manuals are needed. Please update them. If you see anything, let us know. We need to update. And we'll see where we go with it and how far we can go with it. There is one thing which you have to have in mind. Even though we are showing new systems, new energy systems, new development technology, this is not our aim. Keshe Foundation, SSI, is a spaceship program. We are still heading and we are working at the position to be able to show the flight system in the coming months. This is our target. At the same time, once we achieve flight, we should be able to show people can use it. It's not just a, what do you call it, something which can fly. We need the energy system for it, we need the water system for it, we need the medical application for it. So this is all building up towards one point in the pyramid, and it's needed. If you find, we've seen our Chinese doctor yesterday teaching in the private teachings. We've seen scientists from different parts of the world coming here for a day, half a day, or 2 or 3 days, and sharing their knowledge with us all across the world. So, soon we will have a collaboration with a couple of universities where the scientists and the professors will bring in the knowledge of the designs for a space technology. These are the scientists who've been working with us in the background. They'll come on board to show you how to do. There is a procedure which we are considering for car manufacturing, that the new cars which can hover, or what you call a lift situation, is done totally in a new design condition. These are the scientists, professors from university which have worked for years on these projects, but they could not find the technology to fit their ideas in. So you will see a lot of these developments, and all will be done through here, through the Keshe Foundation. In next week, we could announce a new collaboration on the medical application of the technology with the health side. We'll see how the negotiation goes. And as I said, Giovanni is looking at me in a very funny way. We could announce the collaboration of the Keshe Foundation with the one of the world government space programs. We all at the moment are standing by. If it happens, and we think it's very high possibility will happen. The next step out of commercialization is a space technology and collaboration with governments, as we've done now with Ghanaian Space Institute. We'll go to the next step up at the highest level with the sanctions of the what we call the presidents of the nation. If it happens the way we see this, it's very well on track. So, on the other hand, we need to understand, as beautifully put on this screen just now, we got to learn a new way. At the moment, you go, you buy a power generator, you plug it in and it just produces, you run the fuel and run the electricity. You've seen it how methodically you have to follow a step to be able to use, because once you use this technology the way it's set, then you will understand, as the wires in the house are nano-coated, you can produce your energy unit anywhere. You can put your medical unit, if your child is sick, you put the medical unit in his room, because the plasma is already received through your wiring in the house at a point where you want it. It's just translation of the plasma into the health application where the child can receive the plasma it needs for the condition they are in. These are the new products which will be launched. And as I said, please, we put as many blueprint days on, weeks on, that you can all copy the technology. We need you to do it, but totally in one go. It's moved to one direction. It's been such a pleasure. I would have been looking at, if somebody showed us a system working or building in Germany or here in Italy or whatever. But when you see people in small islands are doing it, this is the pleasure of it. We have reached where we wanted to reach, to masses. You see very little island in Caribbean, small islands in Africa, the small nations, scientists are doing it. We have got to the point in Ghana that we cannot more or less do anything but start teaching other nations in Africa. We have come to the point that the world leaders are realizing there is an opportunity they want to bring to their nation. We have a person who's becoming 100% the next president of a nation, close friend of the foundation. He wants the foundation to be there as part of the support for his election, and he knows it's going to be, but it shows he can deliver energy to a country which is needed. We have received a request from the possible future first lady of a nation, inviting the foundation to be as part of the development for his, her husband's election opportunities in the future, in the coming months. We have collaboration with the world leaders who understand what it is, but they were waiting for the power unit to come to show its power that they can stand, they don't make a mistake. And now the power of our units are out. We are strong enough to stand criticism, but we are in strong enough to understand the collaboration. In the coming weeks, you will see how the technology will evolve. The Maglev units, which we sent out with ambassadors, some have a problem because the scientists put 2 meters on either side, they blocked it. Now they have to restart it, and some of them have damaged the system because of it. Because they blocked, it become too resistive, so the system doesn't play as a plasma system, it tries to play as a matter system. But as we say, as the Arabs say, they call ostrich a camel bird. They say, where is your hump? He says, I'm a bird. They say, if you're a bird, why don't you fly? He says, I'm a camel. So the system, with putting it in the middle, you trapped it between the two, half operation, you heat it up, and they opened it, and they see the problem. But now we realize we have problem, but on the other hand, we have to teach for people to understand, like we saw in the video. The process is becoming very fast. In the next couple of weeks, we will release new equipment for this technology. We manufacture it. The new plug system will show you tomorrow, most probably by next Thursday. You will see adaption to the plugs that you can plug in. The cassette size for the backup as a what a cascading unit. It's literally the same thing in a very short level to go into the house in different position to speed up the process and give you more power to 5.4 and heating. The technology today, as we speak, has been granted finance by the Italian government for its use in conjunction with another system in Italy. It was sanctioned this week, which means an organization took one of our systems and they said, we want to use this system in conjunction with our system. They tested it, it's been accepted. And this company, what they're telling us, they want to build their new factory with a new system next to ours, where we are producing our units. That the collaboration, whatever is produced, are part of it. And most probably the what we are negotiating is that the new, the company, which is well established here in Italy, will become part of the Keshe Foundation structure, because not only they are using the Maghreb power, now they use the heating system and other systems which we developed for the Maghreb. So merger of the two companies is inevitable. Is actually, I was told this morning that we have to do it. Said we are putting the factory somewhere else, so we are moving next to you because we need the two to be together. And then there is a talk that we share the factory floor, and then the foundation and the company, which is a well-established, well-known company in Italy, becomes part of the Keshe Foundation. We'll announce this within the next few weeks. So in Italy, we've been given a lot of support by people and the governments and the authorities, and we have not let them down. We've seen the first hundreds of jobs created in Italy today. And then this will multiply. We are inviting the press next week to be able to demonstrate the work of the unit. They can do whatever they like with it. And then the new pen, what do you call it, paint pens, Italian one, will show you tomorrow or next week. The same will be with the new paint pads. The paint pads are manufactured in Italy. They look absolutely gorgeous. As I said to you, when you look at the pens, as we see from Philippines, they look so beautiful that you want to get sick to use it. It's an Italian love affair, I called it. It's just that you have to get too sick to see just if it works. So we'll show it to you. It's beautiful. And we know between us and Brennan that because of the structure we use and the structure they use, it's a different power system. So we need the two. If you want a weaker system, you pick the Philippine condition pen. If you want a stronger system, we can do the Philippines can do the same, but the way the structure of the pen does not allow that capability, but they can produce it. So you see the technology in the next 3-6 months will take totally new shape. And if our negotiation tomorrow afternoon finalizes with the satellite company here, the television company with all the workers become part of the Keshe Foundation. It's not just that we're taking a satellite, we are merging a television station directly into the back of the Keshe Foundation with all the auditors, with all the workers, with the camera crew and everything else. So it's a vertical process. That was a surprise to Giovanni. He thought he knows everything. But when we speak to you about the satellite teaching, and in a way we advertise on the platform of our own products, because the more products can become naturally accepted worldwide, then we see what we're looking for, neutralizing the interaction of the field of these reactors with the human body to calm the need, the demand of aggression down. And then we not only set the governments for the world peace plan, we prepare the humanity on a psychological level to accept peace. Because now you have everything you need. We give you everything you need, the water, the energy, the food, even the space program. As I always said to my workers over years, if I take your worries away, you work perfect. And this is how I did. Even if you look at the structure of the teachings, every company starts 8, 10 o'clock, 8, 9 o'clock in the morning. The staff have to rush to be there 9 o'clock, putting the children to school. When they get to the office by 9 o'clock, it's half aggression because everything had to be done. And then they have to find a loophole in the middle to get to the bank and do the shopping. Here, you start 10 o'clock. If it doesn't work, 10:30 is still the same. Because the purpose is to teach, is not to create mayhem for the others to enjoy. This is the way the life has to become. We contribute according to the pleasure of the contribution. And slowly, we bring the ethos of the work into the structure of the human life. So, as you see, what I planned years ago, now is coming to fruition. Very interesting point. We have to unite. Even our enemies, we are sending free units to. Not as a sign of our weakness, but as a sign of our greatness. All the people who oppose Keshe Foundation, even they never made a nano material in their life, in the coming days will receive a free unit. People in Antwerp, people in Bulgaria, people in other part of the world who've been sitting in the opposition, we give you a free lift. The gift is yours. Use it. At least when you understand it, maybe you understand your mistakes. Nothing to do with us. So, we are not creating enemies. We are uniting. But at the same time, we don't stand on the want of bigness to be attacked. We defend ourselves so heavily that nobody thinks to attack us. Because we are correct. We are correct in our conduct. And this is how, when you set up cash foundations around the world of manufacturing, work from the point of strength of correctness. Because when you conduct it, that's how it is, that's how it goes. So, the biggest problem was to release the Magraph technologies, the power system. We done and we taught.
Mr. Keshe, just one sec. I thought I seen, okay. Rick just actually dropped out. Rick, are you there? Yeah, I seen, what happened to you?
We had a power outage here just for a few seconds. It was enough to kill all the computers and knock out the live stream. So I just reconnected into Zoom and reconnected the live stream. We lost a little bit there, but I thought I wouldn't disturb the flow and just keep going here.
Thank you very much. We won't lose anything. We can re-upload all the recordings, so that that shouldn't be a problem.
How about a few minutes or 10 minutes?
It was earlier, about 10 or 15 minutes ago before you got into this part. So I think it'll be okay. It wasn't for that long. It was about a 2-minute outage or something like that.
Okay, no problem.
Mr. Keshe, I just want to advise you as well that on Facebook I've seen a couple of pictures from Keshe Foundation Nigeria.
Yes, Keshe Foundation Nigeria, the center will be open next Thursday.
Looks like they're already in a center.
Yes, for the official opening. Can you put a picture up?
Let me download them and I'll put them up when I get them.
As I said, Alex is on the full payroll of the Keshe Foundation and he's setting up heavily. We are supporting and financing the setup of the Foundation Center. This is where Ghana or Nigeria. Nigeria, yes. You can see the banners of the Keshe Foundation Nigeria. They have their own logos, they have their own structure. And in so many ways, as I said, African nations have a priority for the Keshe Foundation. South American nations, and in the negotiation, we are talking to a group that our biggest problem at the moment sits in India. India, because of the casting and the cultural structure, we have to be able to open this development for one of the most populated nations on this planet. And we have two ways. I have started negotiations at the highest level in the diplomatic corps, and at the same time, we have found a partner who have already have an operation in India, that they can start the production in India very rapidly. They do not need any financing. We are financing 51% of the production, and they have the what do you call it, infrastructure in India to be able to distribute the units very rapidly. The main thing in India for us and in Africa is not so much energy units in one way, but is the health aspects, the contamination of contaminated waters. This is our priority. Creation of the food and agriculture, being able to produce harvest without the effect of chemical, what you call, materials. A lot of production will go in that way.
Okay, I have the picture shared. If you want to open the Zoom there.
Open your Zoom, no problem. I've just looked at the pictures. Marco has access to it. They received it from Caroline. You got to realize this teaching like today is watched around the world by thousands, hundreds of thousands of people in every nation. So they can see us teaching, and you can see the Keshe Foundation teaching. And this is the, what do you call it, the center is set up to be done. In the official opening of the center will be next Thursday, hopefully, what do you call it, Alex can set up. Alex has a huge problem on his hand, this one man, and now is requested by the other nations, African nations, to do the same. So we are bringing him back here as Keshe Foundation Nigeria with their own flag. They even have a telephone number. They're well equipped. So bringing financial and support for world peace. You need people of these nations to become part of the Keshe Foundation teaching support. If you are of any of the nationals, of any of the African nations, and you have access to the structure of the country, we support you. I have organized a few meetings with a number of African nation ambassadors who you saw in the World Peace presentation. In a way, by distributing the first units to them, that allows us to start calling on their development. If you are any in any of the African nations, you're producing your own nanomaterial, your own GANs, and you think you don't know enough, if you manage to make the coils and the power units, get in touch with the Keshe Foundation support. We will support you to teach your nation. We support you to set up your own centers of teaching and manufacturing. Especially manufacturing is our main target. If you have managed in Namibia, in what do you call it, any of the African nations, to produce, replicate our work, it means you have understood it, or you're trying to understand it, and you can teach it to the others. The Keshe Foundation worldwide will support you to set up the factories that in your own means, you can produce it. I have ordered 20 units of the winding system to be produced by the Keshe Foundation Canada, by Jeff DuPont, once they completed it. And these 20 units are for African nations, which means in setting up, you can immediately go into production. You can reuse the wires which are there and everything else that we can support you, because this technology has to be used by total of humanity in one level at the same time. We set a standard, and please, if you follow our standard, which is for every unit you sell to the others, you give, that they can have it freely, has to be part of the work. As I said in other talks last week, is the way Brennan is. A correct man, he wrote to me, that we have made a profit, that the Keshe Foundation profit is so much, I want to send you the payment to the bank. And I wrote to him, says, you don't need to pay us. Make more units, what is our profit, and give it freely on the streets of Philippines to the people as part of the Keshe Foundation. This is the way we work. This is the way you've got to work. Don't join us or don't see us as a honeypot. See us as a process to give system to the others that they can have the same opportunity, free from pain, free from energy, free from food restrictions, that we can work. One of the biggest problem is governments cannot stop this movement anymore. We become too big and we become too many of us that there is no border restriction. It's just understanding what is going to do and what we can accommodate. So if you are in a third world nation, we are there to support. We see through you. If you are trying to be nice to get in to become millionaires, very soon you find out the only richness you receive will be through your soul, because you give you a shirt. When you see a crying man with a child in front of you, I don't have food to give and I can't feed my child, you give a unit away and then you give the whole factory away. This is how it works. We don't tap into your physicality, we tap into your soul through the need of enjoying to give. So it's nice to see these things. We have one of the most beautiful souls, what I call Alex, with us, and I trust him so much in the way that he works, the ethos of the Keshe Foundation, in developing the technology, that I have given my two sons for him to teach them the ethos of the foundation. My two sons sits on the board of directors of Keshe Foundation UK, but fully supported by Alex. And you've seen what he's done in Nigeria. Is there anything else we can have a look at?
I did bring Curl into the panelists. Or do you have anything else there, Rick, before we go to?
Oh yes, there's quite a bit more. If we wish,
I'll let you go ahead.
Well, we could continue on the just on the ones on the Keshe Foundation Blueprint website, for example, and just sort of browse through those, so we can, because they, those people have been up for a bit, and be nice to show that their work. Let me get the screen share here. And okay, so we saw the one from Guadeloupe, and we saw Ali from Vancouver. Now there's we've got Peter and Andreas from Austria. There's a little video, we can have a look at that. I think I might have to reshare, because I need to stick on the sound unit here. Okay, there we go. And where is the video? Oops, that's not it. Yep. Okay, so let's play that.
Welcome to Free From Fuel 2, the Nano Workshop. The first 8 episodes show you what this is all about. Now here is the first DIY lesson. We will make a nano coating for copper wires. Simple and free of costs. From scrap, a campfire and a bucket of water. We can use the nano coated copper wires for a lot of fascinating experiments. But this for later. In the second part of the film, I show you a more sophisticated variant for those who like it complicated like me. We use chemicals then instead of a campfire. Okay, here we go. Take an old cable. We just need the wires inside. Cut the cable into pieces of 50 centimeters each with a pair of pliers. Open the hole with a sharp knife and get the wires out. Dismantle the wires with a wire stripper. Screw in the bare cords and wrap them around a pencil just like that. Makes a fine copper coil.
Can we pause it?
You can also use brand new copper wire from a wire.
Yeah.
I think we were talking about this before, Mr. Keshe, with the braided wire compared to the solid wire. Can you explain the difference there? Because he's using
braided. We prefer not to use, because the braided wires create composite fields. And we are not set for that yet, because how you tighten the braided wires together or how you twist them together gives different results.
I think you were talking about multi-strand wires, weren't you?
Not braided, stranded wires.
Yeah, right. Okay. Now, this video is actually kind of long.
Multi-stranded wires the same.
Right. Okay. Yeah, I can understand that. This video is kind of long. I didn't really expect that. We could...
It's very nice to see it. No problem.
Okay.
I would like to see his vegetable pot.
Maybe we should go full screen on it or something here to...
Yeah, if you can do that, Rick, that'd be great.
I'm not sure if it can handle everything here. I'll try, though. We'll see what happens.
Oh, come on. You have the powerhouse of a computer now.
Boy, but an old cable also does it.
It's the live stream.
Dismantled with a wire stripper.
Agricultural. The herbs are pot. Can you go forward?
I think he was using herbs in the nano coating process.
Mm. We'll teach you about this later on. It's very good.
Okay, keep going.
Do you want to just go from here then? Okay.
Yeah, go to the herbs and let's see.
The herb part, okay.
Well, I think on this
cold water,
he talks about, sorry, Rick, he talks about coating with fire and then coating with caustic on this video.
Uh-huh.
You want to see the whole video, Mr. Keshe?
No, just where he goes to the vegetables in the cooking pot.
Okay, so you want to go more to the end, Rick, where he discusses the fire in the beginning and then the caustic method after. I think it's about the 7-minute mark-ish.
I've been lost.
7 minutes. No, I'm here. I'm just trying to. Here's the nano coating.
We don't see it moving on the screen here, Rick.
I'm sorry, you don't see anything on the screen? Also, I was wondering about.
Yeah, that now it's moving. Yeah, when you had it on full screen there, it wasn't moving. So you wasn't going through it.
Okay.
So I see there that it's been changed. So you can go back just a little bit on that video and we'll just keep it on the small size and it works better.
Okay, so
I think it's back.
I know what I can do. I can make it bigger this way perhaps.
Yeah.
Is that better?
Yeah, that's better.
There we go.
The people we had dinner with.
Okay. Now we go. Okay, so we're on still nano coating and we'll keep moving along.
I think it's back at the 7-minute marker.
7 minutes.
Yeah, okay. There it is.
Oh, okay. From there, say? Okay, let's try that.
So I put it into the solution. And into the solution. And remember, put on gloves. They have to be waterproof and much stronger than these. Pour 1 liter of boiling water into the bowl. Take care not to inhale the vapor. And do this outside. And immediately put the lid on. Take care that as little vapor as possible is lost. The vapor must stay inside. Within the first minutes, you can watch the aluminum foil dissolve. So, be very careful. After 3 hours, it's cooled down and looks like this. Looks a bit disgusting, but mostly harmless. Doesn't smell as bad as it looks, but I think you shouldn't trust my nose. I poured it into this measuring jug, but it was too small. I should have poured it directly into the bottle if I'd had a cone. Pouring and pouring. The bottle is not suited for food anymore. Please mark appropriately and store safely. Mount a spray head from the scent shop. And use good gloves. This really burns the skin. And now, screw tight. The vapors must stay inside. Our coating is ready for use. This is the chemical variant. Well, just holding the copper into the fire would have been much easier. But some of you perhaps like to do it this way. By the way, after a week, my coating storage bottle looked like this. The thread totally disintegrated, just like before when we mixed the solution. So don't store this in a Coca-Cola plastic bottle. We are still not done yet. Now comes the nano-coating. The fire and water method would have been much easier. So again, dismantle an old cable and wrap the wires around a pencil to get a fine coil. An expensive wire also does it. Wrap around a marker in both rotations. Make sure that your coils will fit into the bottle in which the coating will take place. The copper coils go into a clean bottle. Taking the coils out again in the end was difficult, so please make sure you use a wide neck bottle. The narrow neck bottle I used here was no fun at all. Apply one or two sprays from the coating mixture. We don't need the solution here, but just the vapor. It's just a nano coating.
What did they use? We didn't see the beginning, it's okay.
Screw tight. Vapor now fills the inside, which will coat the copper coils within the next 24 hours. First, it looks like this. Put the bottle into the sunlight. After a few hours, it looks like this. Turn it around occasionally. And remember, use a wide neck bottle. Otherwise, you will have a hard time getting the coils out again. After a day, it looks like this. Everything is coated in black. But we are still not done. We now have to decrease the potential of the coils. The African fire and water method is definitely a bit quicker, though. We need a galvanized fence. You get such a roll from the hardware store.
Okay.
Or you ask your neighbor for some pieces.
Okay, Rick.
Thank you very much. It's very nice the way we're getting information in this way from everywhere. But if you want to nano-coat in a very fast effective way, without any chemical side effect, use your plasma power unit. and put it before than after, because the power after the system is much weaker than the one before. You take 1 kilowatt hour out, but you put 4 kilowatt hour into the grid. So whatever you want to nanocoat, I show you in the environment, you can create exactly like Coca-Cola bottle. But you put, can we go on a full screen? Maybe we can teach something here. Yeah, but what you can do, there's one way to do it, but you have to know how to do it. It's very important. It's, if you create, this is your power unit, and this is your supply line, where you connect to your, what do you call it, the meter or whatever. If you nanocoat this wire here, if I can go black, when you nanocoat, what is going on here? Why don't I get my black? Okay. When you nanocoat it, and you have already nanocoated the wire from the power supply, you can create an environment here where the plasma becomes part of the environment of this. All you need to do, you put your wires connected to this point and this point, but in this environment. If we don't connect it either, it's the same, you will see the perfect plasma nanocoating. So you create like a plasma box between your power supply and your grid, and you pile the whole wires, whatever you want to nanocoat, in a way, the matter point, whatever, to here. Instead of nanocoating before there, you create a perfect, this is one of, this is a plasma creation of the plasma. That is absolutely perfect. You'll never have a problem with it, but with this kind of plasma making, the direction of the flow of the plasma will become irrelevant. When you made caustic nanocoating, when you made the fire nanocoating, the winding will be affected, left or right or whatever you want to call it, clock or anti-clockwise. But when you nanocoat with a plasma, it's the way we explain in the space when you go, if you go to higher strength, the plasma of the answer body changes to the one. So when you create a nanoplasma coating with the wires, especially if you do it in a specific way, it's irrelevant if you do it clockwise or anti-clockwise, as you have now with your system. The system, as we talked earlier, you had to change because you did the wrong clockwise or anti-clockwise. When you nanocoat with the plasma, it's the plasma which turns according to the direction of flow. You understand? This is what Einstein called the funny thing, he never understood. So, this is what I said, these plasma unit production units is what we are going to use in the factory. It's easier. Once now we produced it, we make our coils just connected. All you need to do is just make a mesh, which the wire connection goes through the mesh, and your system gets nanocoated. It's a specific way to do it. You've got to be taught how to use it. Otherwise, your nano, your, let's say, copper wires, your coils, become resistive system. You have to coat it in a specific way that they become part of the plasma, that they get coated by the plasma. In a way, it's like going to a sauna, or when you make a, when you smoke a fish, you don't put a fish on a fire, but you create a smoke that the smoke attaches itself. This way, plasma, you have to understand how to do it. We're going to teach it in one of the blueprints, where your plasma, because it's a dynamic plasma, is not an attachment plasma, then it doesn't matter if you put your coil upside down or clockwise or anti-clockwise. It changes as it needed, It goes down in power and it comes up to the power as you need it. This is part of the production of power units when we start teaching you. This is applicable only, you'll see the beauty of it when we become power generated through the plasma. Not at this moment. And then I'll teach you how to do it. Yeah. Yeah. You got to understand, some of you who've been producing plasmas in a mass, or what you call it, power supplies, you must have seen some black spots on the ceiling of your room where the electric current is passing. And you're all wondering, what are these black spots? In a way, the energy which is coming from your cable is creating a magnetic field that in that environment, the plasma is interacting and you're creating nanomaterials on your ceiling, according to what matter is mixed in the plaster of their ceiling. You're literally nano-coating the whole house, you're becoming part of it. This is how it's in the space. In the spaceship, you don't have a room. You're part of the plasma. If you ever thought that by making the spaceship structure of the star formation, you only have the three reactors and the fourth one on the top, and you make yourself the, what do you call it, the spaceship. Don't forget, the whole thing is a plasmatic condition. And if you look, you shouldn't be afraid of it, because you live on one, you call it the Earth. So now we go into real space technology. We go into the step that everything we produce itself converts itself to a plasma. It's us, and the conditions we create dictates if it's going to be a matter state or a Gans state or nano state. So production of, this is what I was telling our manufacturers for a couple of weeks, and I said, you do carry on the first production of the units, and then we use the units to create nano-coating of the plasma. Then you don't have to worry about anything. And they keep on, when is the time to start? I said, when the units become perfectly the way I want them, because there's a steps to be done, then all we need to do, we literally put two or three of our units in the back and the front, we create an environment that everything nano-coating, it's just literally smoking it, but in a plasma instead of heat. So in the coming time, if any of you understood what I'm talking about, please try it and come and show us. Otherwise, you will see a fantastic smoking chamber of plasma. Don't forget, we use the same knowledge in a spaceship program to feed you. We create the plasma of a banana, you will have banana. You create the plasma of orange, you all will have an orange. So it's a step towards the space technology, spaceship program, that you understand, gradually, step by step, where we are going. What's the time, please? So I have to leave in half an hour, because we have a group of, bunch of students next door, in another classroom. I have to go and give a talk to them for a few minutes. I'll leave it to Marco to carry on with the rest of the teaching today. I'll bring you a cap, don't worry. Yeah, I'm not wearing it. Rabbi. Oh, the Pope wears it the same. Yeah, we call it a soup pot. My brothers and I said, we're going for a soup with our own pot. When you go for Shabbat dinner on Friday night, is to eat chicken soup with rice. So when we used to cap, we say, oh, we are here with our own pots, can we have some? My grandmother used to go crazy with us. Okay.
Mr. Kersh, I thought we could run through maybe some of the other people that are involved.
What these other things you have to learn when it comes? Is a teaching and a blueprint together, and a new development.
So this is another one of the characters. The characters on the wall. This is Shandor, of course, and he's got a series of pictures and a video on how to do the stripping of the wire and so on. He's got a special.
Oh, we've seen this before.
Right, and yeah, that's in
the
previous
one.
Okay, we got Emilio Cinelli, and he's also got a insulation stripper and coiler video. Would you like to see that? Let's see how long it is first. It's a minute.
Do we have anybody
hey guys.
With us?
With what? Pardon me?
1 minute, yeah, please.
1 minute? Okay, let's play it then.
This is Emilio from Taiwan. And I was making these Keshe power unit coils and came up with a way where you could just make the coils, you see the bare copper here, without stripping the wire. Or without stripping it ahead of time, I should say. What I did is I got a potato peeler. I used one of those little white clampy things, I don't know what they're called, to connect it. And what you basically do is just go.
Brilliant.
Yeah, it is.
And you're done. So I hope this helped you, and please share it.
Well, there you go. That may have beat Shandor's stripper, and I think Guy's even a little jealous of his stripper that he had worked out.
It's becoming absolutely brilliant the way things are taught.
Yeah.
It's Shandor.
I think
here.
He needs definitely a pattern right on this.
Yeah, Shandor is taking exception
here. Sorry, it's Shandor here. Please don't say Shandor's pillar. I just found it on a video on YouTube. I was just that who found it, and somebody else invented the method.
Okay.
I was thinking to find the best way how to strip the wire. So this is how I found it on YouTube.
I think it's an ancient.
Now you've seen it, how it's been developed, a new evolution in the potato peeler.
I think it's an ancient Egyptian method, probably.
Anyway, well, the one-step coiling and the stripping is genial. It saves a lot of work.
Okay. Carl, I see that you're here. I haven't been able to get you to respond.
Carl is there. Hi, Carl.
Hello, Mr. Pass. Can you hear me?
You become like a newsman for China for us.
Yes.
Okay, what's news?
Yes, I just got connected the fabric to the system, to the four motors of the star formation.
And
I need to test whether I can levitate.
Are you going to do that live for us there, Carl?
Yeah, of course. But I'm not sure you can. Can you see?
Yes, we can.
Wait, come on. 不是你定一下，你等一下。 Okay.
Oh, they have connected it to the fat man, fat boy.
Yeah.
And that's inside that pyramid structure, correct?
Yeah, just prevent the people coming around and prevent them from electric shock.
Okay, what's the position? Have you started loading yet or not?
Yeah, it has been loaded.
And?
Is it running, Carl?
Yeah, it is running.
You have to make sure the coils don't receive the same amount of energy, huh? You got to make sure the coils receive different energy, that the difference.
Yeah, how do you think how to connect them? Because I connect them after the unit. Maybe I can connect them before the unit.
No,
can you not use
the unit? If you connect it before the unit, you have a more powerful supply. But okay. Start with the front or connect two of the cores or one of the cores to the after and three to before.
Okay.
Yeah, that you have to create a potential gravitational magnetic field difference to be able to create that, then they start sucking on the plasma what they need.
Okay.
Because if you get it right, that thing in there should fly. This, as I told you, this is my biggest hope. Carl, please speak to Lisa.
Okay, I will speak to him. I will speak to her.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And because we're trying to bring your center indirectly as part of the production, manufacturing part, shareholding of the Keshe Foundation China. So we need you to come online.
Yeah. Okay, I will.
In a way, what we're trying to do from the production, manufacturing, we're trying to finance your research center to become bigger for teaching.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Anything else? Very strange. 6 months ago, a year ago.
That's all.
Yes, sir. Maybe getting to 2.5 hours is getting long enough. Now 3 hours and it's still going. No question asked. He's been nano-coated, nano-conditioned.
We have Eduardo Denise from North Carolina, USA. He just shows his coils and another picture of the nano-coated coils. And it looks to be a setup in a lathe. A lathe with a winding machine, yes, a winding setup.
He's using a center lathe machine, yeah.
Yep.
Interesting. The unit which Jeff DuPont is doing is more or less works on the same condition, but in one coil. I've seen their separate coil being nano-coated. Try to put your coil inside each other if you're nano-coating caustic. It's easier than inserting afterwards. Next one.
Okay, this is more from Ali from Vancouver.
Those are the older videos, Rick.
I'm still going through.
Has Richard arrived home to show us what he's done?
I'm not sure. Another one, Marijo from Croatia. And again, it's a bunch of coils. These are some of the earlier ones, but Thomas from Austria, showing the counterclockwise and clockwise coil formations. Nate from USA. And there's a couple of other links there that we could see more. There's Crystal from Vancouver.
We see a lot of women who start nano-coating. Somebody wrote yesterday, I'm a housewife, but I don't want to pay for it. I'm going to make it myself.
Okay. Yeah, this... She's ready for action, armed with the drill and wire.
Action, lady of action, yeah.
Yeah.
We're getting a lot of females now that they understand it can change the structure of their billing at home. This is why they are coming on board. You have to understand, they know women are the most, the best economists in the world, because a man goes to work, but he gives what he earns to a woman. So she's a budget maker. She knows every cent she cuts from waste, she can do something else for her children. And in the past few weeks, we've seen a rush of women who are actually wanting to nano-coat, learn. And we saw what our friend said from the United States. They have 500 women and children who are making nano-coating because they know the money they don't pay for electricity, they can heat the children up, they can have a comfortable environment, is what they can spend on the house and the children for food. And we've seen a huge surge in women.
Yeah,
the husband,
that's true.
Their friends, and they are making it. They don't want to pay the 1,000 euro or 200 euro for whatever.
Yeah.
And they can see it themselves. I've heard as a group of women are getting together, teaching each other how to coil.
Right. I was going to say they used to teach each other how to knit, but now they're doing coiling and taking it a lot further than knitting did.
So we see, because these are the people we rely on, that they will change the structure, and that's where we want it to be able to change the household, rich in application of the technology, and the women very soon because they sit on the top of the Keshe Foundation. If you men don't take it so easy.
Okay. And then we're down to early shots of Richard here. And he's got...
He's there with his hands, I can see him.
He's got some beer. And it would be better maybe to get some later pictures right from Richard.
How about we just stop your screen share and go live to him, Rick?
We could. Oh, yeah. Okay, Richard, I see that now.
What happened to the gentleman in Austria who was... Hi, Richard.
Good evening. Good morning. Afternoon, actually.
I do have a video from the What Limit Club, which may be the one you're talking about, Mr. Keshe. There's a 6 minute.
Can we have a look at that one, please?
Okay.
We come back to you, Richard, in 1 minute.
Yeah, that's okay. I'll just continue.
Okay, let me do that here. Just a second. Get this lined up.
You see, he's made his own coil. Fantastic.
Okay, move Richard out, and this is the video. Oh, I didn't do the sound thing, just a minute, I have to check that first. Screen share, back to here, yeah.
I think if you check it once, I think it's always checked on the same meeting.
That seems to be true, yes, Vince, thanks.
Okay, good.
Okay, let's play that.
It's time to load durch die Musik, welche immer etwas mehr und weniger laut ist, ändert sich die Last dauernd. Ich kann euch mal den Anschluss zeigen. Wir kommen hier mit der Zuleitung von der Steckdose, um verschiedene Steckdosen auszuprobieren, in verschiedenen Räumen mal einzustecken. Von hier aus haben wir den Nullleiter, der zu dem Gerät führt, und auf dieser Seite die Phase, auf den Eingang ganz unten. Hier haben wir den Anschluss vorläufig mal provisorisch mit den Krokodilklemmen ausgeführt. Hier geht es zum Verstärker. Hier kommt die Leitung vom Magraf-Device. Ich hoffe, man kann das sehen. Interessant ist auch, ich habe bisher keine Temperaturveränderung feststellen können. Gestern schon hatte ich konstante, immer gleich warm. Auch die Kabel, da das natürlich nicht perfekt ist. Stecker kommen bald dran. Kabel 22 Grad. Da bleibt alles kalt. Zu den Kondensatoren, den Kapazitor, mache ich mal einen...
I'm in a stereo system, would that be considered a resistive load or a non-resistive load?
It depends how it's done. It's both.
Well, because I use MOSFETs in there to increase the power, right? So
it's both.
Yeah. Thank you, Rick. Go ahead. Sorry.
Okay, so I just took it up into the air conditioning here, which is more comfortable to work. So what I do.
What is this one?
Ich kann euch mal den Anschluss zeigen. Ja. Auf den Eingang ganz unten. Hier haben wir den Anschluss, vorläufig mal provisorisch mit den
excuse me, gentlemen, I have to leave for a few minutes to talk to these students in the other room, and I'll come back. Marco will take over. Yeah, you can continue with this, he says, the boss.
The temperature Veränderung feststellen können. Gestern schon hatte ich konstante auch die Kabel, da das natürlich nicht perfekt ist. Stecker kommen bald dran. Kabel 22 Grad. Da bleibt alles kalt. Zu den Kondensatoren, den Kapazitor, mache ich mal einen eigenen Clip demnächst. Ich hatte da ein Problem, ich habe es zuerst gleich mit den Kapazitoren angeschlossen, einen Bypass machen, da ich ein Problem bekommen habe, vermutlich mit dem mittleren Kondensator, der bei der Montage so auseinandergerutscht ist und ein Problem verursacht hat. Und da ich noch dachte, dass es da liegt, habe ich an den Kapazitor vorbei angeschlossen, um den Fehler zu isolieren. Und, von da an hat das Device funktioniert. Als nächstes werde ich dann nebst den Stecker an den Stromkabeln, werde ich hier schauen, dass ich die Kapazitor zum Laufen bekomme. Und More Hardware für Leistungsaufnahme und Rückgabe sollte eintreffen, dann kann ich das anschließen und dann habe ich auch Informationen über den Verlauf der Kilowattstunden. So viel für den Moment.
Not hearing any audio there yet, if you're trying to do any. Now I do.
You unmuted me?
No, you're good. Yep.
Okay, good. I was just actually in the process of making the capacitors or remaking the capacitors, and I made some tests. And now I finally made up these. So what I've done, I've made GANs on paper, and I dried the paper, then I cut it in pieces, and now you can really take like an electrode, and I actually don't have a piece now to make it with. Just a sec, me see if I can make that. No, I just don't have a long enough wire. So what you basically do is you get this paper, not this one, another one. And what I do, I'm making this the opposite direction, right? I'm not even known to say what direction it is now. I'm making a counterclockwise rotated coil set. So everything I have is this direction. So I just show you, so make sure that you see what direction I'm using to not get confusion. Wait. Focus. Yeah. Come on, get it. Where's my focus point? Just go that way. Correct. That's right. So I'm not sure if I have the right set or the wrong set now, because there's still some confusion in that. So that will be the next question. But okay. So I'm continuing this one. And what I have now is I'm making these capacitors. So what I do, I just take the paper and I roll it. Be careful, because it's just, it wants to move out of the way. So you can quickly do this and get it right. So what you have now is a thin layer of paste that was dried on that paper and just getting stacked.
How long was that piece of paper?
I can measure it. Give me a sec. It's moving around too much. And then when I have it around it, I can just keep on rolling it and it will tighten. Make sure that it's already pretty much in position. And keep rolling. It's like making a firecracker. We use the same technique. So
just remember that firecrackers are dangerous.
Oh yeah, that's true. This is
making this is a firecracker. It's just the same as making a firecracker. Oh, that simplifies. That clarifies it. Everybody remembers that.
Okay, everybody gets it, I hope.
We wonder about your past now, though.
So this doesn't fit. So I just roll it off a bit. Take off a piece. And then it goes in. You see this? And now it wants to focus, right? Finally. So I'm just fixing these now, because the ones I made, and I have to correct that for everyone, they were made of a wet, pasty substance on the paper, and then I wrapped it around it, then I took a wire and wrapped that wire around it, so I really pressurized, and what I have is just short in my capacitors that way. So what we have now is more of an interaction level between the outside and the inner core, one wire as being the inside and goes through the paper and has a magnetic gravitational field interaction with the coil around it. That's it. So, but it goes through the paper and has interaction through that paper, which is loaded with the GANs. So this should work. But it's in test phase. So to make clear, this, I'm not claiming it works. I'm just saying, okay, we're testing it now, and it work. If it works, it's perfect. Thank you. So, okay, any questions?
I am Sandor from Hungary. In a recent Romanian language workshop, somebody gave an idea, and I'd like to know your opinion about. In order to avoid that central wire to be accidentally pulled out, he recommended to turn two times paper with the paste, and then to bend the end of the wire, which you leave it a bit longer, to bend it over the paper like a hook, and then start rolling. I have here a piece of wire in my hand, so if I may show it. What is it about? One picture would
but
be...
do you prevent the fact that you can pull it out? Because I had that problem too. You can really easily take this and take the center one, and you can move it out. In this case, it's pretty stuck, but you can move it out. What
so
I've done...
I'd like to show it here.
Yeah.
So you put a bit longer wire, which pokes out on the other end. And when you made about two turns, just twist this end here back, like this. And of course, this is not softened wire, so it's better to be softened by fire before to do that. Sorry for I'm using pliers. You're not supposed to use pliers when it's already nano-coated. Just to soften the wire before using it. So to leave here a bit longer, to bend it over the paper, and then keep it rolled. Of course, here should be against spread like you spread the peanut butter on your sandwich.
Would that not change the field? So don't you want a straight wire there rather than a curved at the
How
one
you
end?
Call this, Sandor? Strudel?
Strudel wire.
Strudel. So anyway, in this case, it's not pull. You cannot pull it out so easily because it hooks here in the middle.
I agree. It's a good way to make it not pull out. But I wonder if the wire needs to be straight on the end rather than curved.
It's putting the plasma field back into the wire. On the other side, it's putting it back into the wire. So
I remember once Mr. Cash told that we shall never leave the straight wire ends because the plasma would flow out, always to curl it back.
Right. It's supposed to flow out through the other end, though. That's the whole thing. If you bend it back, it won't flow out. It'll flow back into the wire itself rather than into the wrapping of the capacitor. Like
that's why I'm asking about your opinion on the.
I'm not going to say you're not wrong, Sandor.
No,
it's just that that's the way that I see it, and I think Rick sees it as well.
Why I'm asking your opinion about that.
Right.
I find it's a field disturbance when you coil it inside that paper back. But if you use it as a preventive measure to put the wire outside and then make a little loop, and it's not part of the locking the paper, but just keeping the, wire in position, I think you can use that. But what I've done, I've done this little twist on the center wire, and it's just the same direction. So what I do now with the wrap, with the shrink wrap, and I just got advice not to use it anymore, so that idea goes out of the window. But still, it now gets in position and it fixes on that little loop, so I cannot pull it apart.
Yeah,
it's really stuck.
What other solutions could we have for the rod not pulling out without deforming the rod shape? I mean, you could maybe glue the paper on or something, but that's not a good thing to do.
Something you really want to prevent any interference with the plasma flow here. So you actually want to have a naked system.
So
that makes it that if you make a cradle to hold
right.
these,
yeah, yeah.
that could prevent the thing just getting out.
And if it was a good loop at each end, maybe the loops could be secured somehow to keep it from rotating and pulling out.
Yeah. That's what I used in the first set I made. I just looped them around, and they're actually in position because of the fact that there is a loop connection there. So you make a base, so upper top connection, and that keeps it in place.
Could have a fireproof base of some sort. I'm not sure what that would be exactly, but it could be a plate, for example, a porcelain type plate. Or
yep.
Mr. Keshe mentioned connecting the capacitors together in the center, I thought. Some sort of radial method, he mentioned, with them all connected in one point in the middle and sort of going out from there. I thought he mentioned that today. Did anybody pick up on that?
Well, he said that they were mounting them naked, so like this, and they used spacers. Like the spacers they use for tiles to separate those crosses. Yeah, and they put them in between, so there's a separation, but then you can basically get the top and the bottom like this connected, so you end up with a cell like this.
But something that comes to my mind right off the bat looking at this, if you were to connect them together like you have in your hand with the little cross plastic in between them, bend the ends where the loops are on each end 90 degrees, and then embed that in plaster of Paris. Just the ends, not the whole capacitor.
These parts.
Yeah, just bend those at 90 degrees down so you're making a U-shape, and what? Embed the little loops into a small block of plaster of Paris.
Oh, yeah.
With the capacitor sticking up, you'd still have some room to wrap your wire and make your connections, but they would be solid. They wouldn't go anywhere. Suppose you could do a linear array that way too, and just have them one beside the other.
There's a question online here for Richard. Is the GANS coated baking parchment paper inside the container on your table, is it completely dry?
It looks completely dry, but it feels that there is still some softness to it. So, but it's dry. When it looked dry, it just came off the plate I dried it on. It just came off. It just as if you put it in the oven, it was wet, and then it dried. Like a bit of wrinkly, you know? So it was dry.
Okay, thank you so much.
Okay, and if you want to add moisture to it again, you just add moisture to it. But I'm having shorts when there's moisture inside, so I think it's better when they're dry. So
yeah,
gas and a little caustic, but a little caustic. I'm not talking about. Just when I had a little spray, I sprayed it inside the process when I mixed it, and it was already pretty dry, pretty pasty. Then I sprayed it a little bit in there, just a little bit, not much. No, so I don't have any salt crystals. I don't have any salt crystals on there. That's right. Yeah. You have to clean your materials from the salts. Yeah. Otherwise, you get in trouble here in this process. And because the salts would just make it short. It's just the conductor. It's just when you have salts in between your coils, you're good. You're probably good to go with throwing it away in the garbage bin.
Okay. Do you have some other things you want to show us there, Richard? Or?
I'll be posting today or tomorrow. I'll be posting the system running with the new capacitors. So
great.
I'll keep you posted.
Excellent.
Okay. Okay. Good luck, guys.
Thank you. Okay. Well, we have a ton of questions, of course. We have a question on the bottom here from Steve. Is Richard using just CO2 and copper oxide GANs?
Well, I'm using different ones.
Right.
All right.
Your secret sauce?
Collage. Yeah, well, yeah, my secret sauce and my secret this. But I don't have so much secrets. I just created different gradient GANSes and different materials and different base sorts. So I just made a nice combination of a few that made it a really dark color and apparently had a lot of oxidization in there, so there was a lot of oxygen, so there's a lot of potential in there.
How do you select the materials for your GAN soup, let's say? What is it that you do as you're selecting, or is it just whatever's handy goes in the soup? Whatever's not going to rot by tomorrow goes in the soup, you know?
yeah. I looked at the fact that you want to have something higher than copper. You're using parts of your machine to be copper, so you want to be a higher gradient than that. So basically a lot of stuff already goes above that, so it doesn't really matter how what you take. If you take just CO2, maybe just that's a bit too light. Maybe you have to use an oxide to it and put extra copper oxide to it, so it makes a higher potential.
Mm-hmm.
But if you use titanium,
I was just going to say titanium.
Extra, do it. Yeah, that came I had to titanium mind. Laying around here, so it's in there.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, titanium oxide is highly rated as one of the more active oxides for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Nanoparticles, nanomaterials, active fields.
And a warning to everybody, don't use red phosphor like me because it can cause damage to your DNA. Thank you.
That leaves a lot to our imagination. Is that what happened to you?
I asked the question. My DNA is, you know, so somehow different than yours now. Thank you.
You were in a radiant field of that. Yeah, could have been.
Oh. Yeah, well. It's true. There are things you don't want to mess with.
No, you don't want to get dangerous stuff in there.
Okay, well, there's the old which winding direction question, I guess. He says, Richard did all his coils previous to the 4/11/2015 update about the winding direction confusion. So Richard is using his old counterclockwise coils and is doing all this stuff now counterclockwise. He knows that it's not the winding direction as presented in the blueprint. Well, yeah,
that's
but it's like Mr. Keshe says, it's all useful, and who knows, it could turn out the ones that are wound backwards may be the ones that work in special, unusual ways, or something, you know, that ends up being better with them for some reason.
Isn't this then the direction of not magnetic, so we end up with the other one, gravitational?
So it might put on weight or lose weight.
Or remove it.
Right, depending.
I just wanted to say that if we are following the rules of construction, which is righty-tighty, lefty-loosey, or right means tight and left means loose, I think that Keshe was dropping us a jewel that some of us took and just didn't understand what he was saying. The counterclockwise coils is what's probably going to cause lift. Why? Because righty is tighty, which means that you're going into the surface of the planet. Lefty is loosey, which would be counterclockwise, which would mean you would be unscrewing yourself from the surface of it.
I agree. And I think there's some reason why we have this convention. And it's only righty-tighty, lefty-loosey for right-hand threads, which are 99.9% of the threads in the world are right-hand threads. But why do we settle on right-hand threads and not left-hand threads as the convention? And I think you're right, as we look into the earth and we think of spiraling into the earth, it's natural for me at least to think of
Which way would the plasma take?
If I was a plasma, I would be rotating clockwise into the earth. I would be turning like a clock. And then if I was going out of the earth, I would feel like I should be unscrewing or turning counterclockwise to get off the earth.
Correct.
I think if I was a plasma, that's how I would feel.
I think he was really kind of giving us a clue, but it slipped past a lot of people. I was telling my people about this before. Do not throw those counterclockwise coils away, because that's how we're going to create lift.
Yeah,
I don't see any reason why not.
I think the same thing. And Keshe gave us another really big clue today, which was you use those coils, which are the magnetical, let's say, in conjunction with the other coils. So you have your the wrong way round coils maybe in the center configuration, and around those you could have your right way wound coils to produce that compression that we've talked about before. So instead of having that single wire like we have in the capacitors and a coil around that, we have the coil itself is like the GANS ball in the center. That wrong way round coil could be like the GANS ball in the center now. And when it's activated, it goes one way. The other coil outside of it goes the other way. And that provides our counter-rotating fields that seem so necessary to provide the actual lift and control conditions there.
And you know something else, Rick? When they launch those spaceships from Cape Canaveral or from wherever they launch them from, if you were to stand directly up underneath that ship, even though it has its own fuel, it starts to go counterclockwise.
Oh, yeah.
Pay attention, y'all.
That's an interesting point. Emmanuel, I see you have your hand up. I'll promote you and see what you have to say here.
Hello. How are you doing?
Hi, Emmanuel. Go ahead.
I wanted to reference perspective on looking at how the magnetical and or gravitational fields generated by the system interact with the plasma of the nanomaterials at the core in a way that we could be looking for not only ways to create lift, but to create light by opening the plasma of the fields of the material itself.
I agree. What if we could use smaller coils to actually create an interaction that created as much light as we wanted, like light bulbs?
Yeah, that's what I had a thought about that. I don't know if anyone's tried to use the coils with a dynamic reactor, but if we could release enough magnetical fields from a dynamic reactor with a coil around it, then I believe there's a way to compress the band of material into a solid like plasma star, and then it would start to have friction inside of the reactor, which would release light and create a plasmatic magnetosphere around the system. So it would create like an aurora borealis effect of some sort, maybe?
Well, it's interesting to note that for example, a light bulb that has a filament in it, the light bulb itself has gases in there, usually like an argon or nitrogen, inert type gases. And when the filament is complete, then it glows like a normal light bulb. When the filament burns out, then of course the light bulb doesn't work normally. But if you were to take that same light bulb and hook up a high voltage plasma bulb power supply to it, then that light bulb without the filament becomes much more powerful than the one with the filament. The one without the filament starts putting out X-rays, actually, whereas the other light bulb just kind of sits there and fizzles a bit. It glows, but it doesn't put out the actual X-rays that the one with the broken filament will. So I'm just thinking that, what about putting a broken filament light bulb in the center of this configuration? Not that we want to generate X-rays. Well, in a way we do if we were creating a different type of reactor, maybe not the one for the home power necessarily, but for other reactors where we want that initiation of the ionization initiation and so on, then that might be a way to do it with this coil arrangement. The compression could actually cause that light bulb to light up, in effect. And that could be the initiation, that those UV rays that are given off from that can initiate the rest of the reactions in the reactor. But that was under a different scenario with gases that were used and so on. That was one of the ways that it might be gotten to operate, let's say. But it could be very similar with this home unit. Maybe there's other parts that could be added to make it, say, turn into a light or turn into a heater.
Eric Colson mentioned some time ago that he excited the gas inside of a light bulb. I believe it was argon, with the plasma fields of the nanowire itself. And there was some research I did into the topic. Argon and potassium are very near strength, I believe. So let me look at that. Yes, argon and potassium are so close in strength that if you created a potassium saturated, well, we already know that if you use potassium to create your nanomaterials, there should be some there, but a potassium saturated nano condition, you should be able to get close to the fields of the argon gas. And the argon is at 39.9, and potassium is 39. So yeah, I believe there's a way to light up these bulbs without any electrical connection, wireless. Someone has a system running already. Try to get one of these already gas pressurized, vacuum chambered argon bulbs and put it near your system and see what happens.
Or a neon, or maybe even the fluorescent bulb could work as well. But definitely neon should be tried, the little neon indicator lights that you can get.
If you have a spectrum of fields, don't just try and put it near it. Try maybe putting it in different locations around it, because maybe it'll light up at a certain distance away or proximity.
Absolutely. It would be in probably one of the intersection points of the fields rather than at a certain distance. So it might be at a focal point somewhere, a node point, let's say.
All right, now I'm just thinking, I don't know how close you'd have to get, but maybe you could fit one in between the little gaps there, between the plates, and the free plasma of the total system would possibly excite it. And you could have you could light up your own room while generating free energy.
I want to look at this like how Mike looked at it the other day when he was talking about the frequency or the characteristics of gold and how he would wrap the coil 81 times or 79 times plus one in order to create it. Light has a frequency also. So if we were to coil a coil at the exact light frequency, why couldn't we just deal directly with the plasma? Interaction.
Yeah, correct. But I don't know if plasma goes directly with the coil length or numbers of coils and so on. For example, when Nikola Tesla was doing his experiments in Colorado Springs, he was not counting the coils on his primary and secondary coil arrangements for generating these huge 40-foot long lightning bolts and that kind of thing. But he was measuring the weight of the copper instead. So you'd have a ratio of the weight of the primary, the huge primary wire, and the weight of the secondary wires wound around. And he had some special ratio combination there that he used that was similar to using coils. Normally you'd have, you know, your coil at the bottom is one or two or three coils or something, and then the coils at the top might be, you know, 1,000 or something like that, and you would have this ratio of 1 or 2 or 3 to 1,000, say. But in this case, it was an actual mass ratio. And it's interesting because Mr. Keshe is often talking about mass in terms of the plasma, and when trying to visualize how these plasma fields will interact and trying to put a number on it, he often uses the masses. So I'm wondering if, and the other reason I say that is I've seen inside the vacuum chamber when coils and so on get used, and it doesn't matter so much the numbers of coils and so on inside of a configuration where there's a low vacuum. It just sort of, the plasma just starts flowing all over the whole configuration. It doesn't care whether there's 5, 10, 15 coils or whatever. It just kind of starts flowing all over everything that's metallic, let's say, or everything that's of a certain range that sticks out, or everything that's sharp, and rather than following the laws of electricity, which are very, very exact in terms of the numbers of coils. The proportions and the numbers have to be so exact. And it may very well be that with these systems too, because Mr. Keshe has explained that the systems have to be exact in certain ways. I'm just not sure if the numbers of coils are that important. As Mr. Keshe has mentioned before, he uses anywhere from, you know, he was talking about, what was it, from 50, 60, 70 for the smaller coil, and then up to from 160, 170, 180 or something like. There's general ranges rather than very, very specific examples. So I'm thinking, at least for Keshe's concepts of that, the numbers of coils and the exact proportions of the coils aren't as important as some other factor, which I'm not clear on exactly, other than possibly weights or maybe configuration in terms of the structure.
Well, Rick, they could actually be combined together.
Absolutely, yeah.
So I don't see any reason why they couldn't, but one of the things that I was thinking about was just plasma. And right now we have been used to electron light.
Mm-hmm.
So plasma light may follow a slightly different variation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that was just my trying to add to the knowledge, fellas.
Yeah, I definitely think so.
I would like to very quickly jump in and go back to the previous topic about coil orientation, because I found something interesting online that I think will clear up the confusion straight away. Okay, I'll just quickly share my screen.
Okay, we've got about 2 minutes left, so we can, yeah, definitely we can get into that a bit. Okay, you should be able to share the screen now.
Moment. Space and go. ABC, sorry, the other one didn't work.
It's okay, Marco. He just has to share the screen.
Okay. Can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay. I'd like to draw everyone's attention to this, the highlighted portion. let's look at the clockwise coil. With the coil curved vertical, eye to the sky and viewed from above, a trace of the metal edge from the inner diameter to the outer diameter involves clockwise movement. Okay? Let's remember that.
No. I don't agree with that at all.
What?
You just totally, that totally goes against what Mr. Keshe has said, that a coil
actually links up with what Mr. Keshe is saying. This is the industry standard for coils.
Yes, but it's not Mr. Keshe's standard, and that's going to confuse things.
Wait.
We shouldn't be calling them clockwise and counterclockwise, because you have to then, as soon as you start saying clockwise or counterclockwise, you have to specify whether you mean the rod or the coil itself. And if you don't specify
Correct.
That before you even say the word clockwise or counterclockwise, then the person that you're talking to is going to assume either the rod is going clockwise or counterclockwise, or the coil.
Please let him finish. Please let him finish.
Okay,
wait,
sorry.
Let me illustrate it with a photo over here. Let me just quickly illustrate it with a photo. Okay? Okay, if you can see the photo that's on screen right now, this coil was wound with a drill going forwards. Now, if we look at the definition that was on screen just now, and we trace from the inner diameter to the outer diameter, this is a clockwise coil. And this is what I did. My coils are all clockwise.
You're saying this is clockwise?
Yes. Yes. This is in air quotes, this is wrong. Okay? This is a clockwise coil. And this is congruent to the description that we read just now on the screen.
Wait a minute. I'm looking, when I look at this screen, I see a coil that seems to be counterclockwise. It seems to have what I call a left-hand thread.
Okay, hang on. You are describing threads. Threads are not coils. Coils are not threads. That the industry standard is different. For coils, you look at it from the inside, and then you trace it out to the outside. So when you look at the inside of this coil, you trace it out to the outside.
I don't know what you're talking about, inside and outside. I have no concept.
Can you draw on
you
the screen there, Vivek, and explain?
I will just draw it. You draw it from the inside going to the outside like that. I think I should choose a different color. Okay. From the inside going to the outside. You see the blue line?
Mm-hmm.
Hello?
Right?
You see the blue line?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so from the inside to the outside, this direction is clockwise. This is the industry standard. And it is congruent with what is described on this page that I'm going to share right now. With the coil called vertical, which is what we just saw, eye to the sky and viewed from above, a trace of the metal edge from the inner diameter to the outer diameter involves clockwise movement.
Wait a minute, though. The inner diameter and the outer diameter, they're talking about a flat coil, not a wound coil, I believe.
No, it's the coil. No, it is the same, actually.
Okay. Okay, carry on. Sorry.
This is the industry standard, because I went to this website, United Aluminium. They are making, well, they do industrial work. And this is the industry standard.
Now, can I say something?
Yeah.
Listen. Mr. Keshe was very clear about one thing, and that is, if you coil a coil one way, just repeat the process. You don't have to change a direction. We are getting completely off of the subject when we do this now. Okay.
I don't think so. I think we just, it's a matter of semantics. We need to clarify if Keshi is talking about thread,
Mr. Keshi,
when he's talking about the flow.
Mr. Keshi did an entire, hold on.
Talking about quotes, because this is an English thing. Let's remember that he's an Iranian scientist. So let's just use our knowledge of the English language, clarify the words that we're using to be clear. Are we talking about the thread flow of the plasma as it travels, or are we talking about the structural stability and shape and industry standard of a coil? Because there's two different topics that we're talking about here, and I see that the only confusion is a simple lack of definition.
I see as a commercial as well as an educational factor that's going in here. A lot of these people are school educated, and you can confuse people with big words and a bunch of mumbo jumbo about how you turn this way to look at things from this different angle. That is all perspective. All perspective. If you're holding that drill in the right hand versus your left hand, all of your perspective changes. So what do? We just make a coil, and then we repeat the same process in the same direction, and now we know that both of our coils are going in the same direction. I don't see how there's a problem.
I would like to tie this in. If you would let me finish, please. If you would let me finish, I would like to tie this in. Going by the definition that we just saw on screen, going by the picture that we just saw on screen, if your drill goes in the forward direction, you will get a clockwise coil. If your drill goes in the reverse direction, you will get an anti-clockwise coil. It's very simple.
And what's the difference between just doing a coil and going in the forward direction with the first one, and then, you know what, putting your drill back and doing the same coil again in the forward direction? You have two coils that are going in the same direction. It's impossible to get confused there.
Yeah, there's no problem. Okay, the thing is, it has to be followed. It has to be followed for all coils.
It's lunchtime. If we cannot agree on this, let's stop this.
This because it gets involved and so on.
Right, it gets involved, but there's lots of questions still regarding it. So that's why we wanted to go over it and make sure that you know, at least if some people understand, then that's great. Take your understanding and stay with your understanding. If you don't understand, then you need a little bit more help, and that's okay. There's lots of people around here that are trying to help as best as they can, and we have to remember, nobody's wrong.
Yeah, that's right. You cannot do mistake with the plasma, so nobody's wrong. Just
right.
Remember this.
Okay, so that sounds good. Let's take a lunch break, and we'll be back in probably an hour.
And that'll be private teaching, I do believe, Rick.
Right, that's true, yes. Not all of us will be back, just the students of the Spaceship Institute, which people can become a student of the Keshe Foundation Spaceship Institute. You can apply at the Spaceship Institute website and become one of the students that hear some of the inner teachings of Mr. Keshe, which is similar to what you hear here, only more so.
We had to stop.
Why?
This discussion about clockwise, anti-clockwise.
Oh, we're still online.
Okay, you can come.
I can come out. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, I'm back in again.
Did you have lunch already?
Did you have a good lunch? Yes.
What happened? Are you on a light lunch schedule now?
Oh, if you want to go on lunch, but after lunch is all plasma.
Yes. Well, did you want to have something to say about this conflict about the clockwise and counterclockwise? Or that was what?
I say what it is, and if I haven't managed to get it into your understanding, the confusion sits in your brain, not in the physicality of transfer of energy from a plasma. It's very simple. If you do it the way we showed it on the drill, what's the discussion with the plasma, clockwise or anti-clockwise? Unless there are people who want to confirm their existence, they have to oppose it, that there is something wrong, then that wasted the energy which we don't need. And secondly, I explained to you that
even if you do it anti-clockwise or clockwise and you think you've done it the wrong way, keep it because it has a lot of benefit. So what's the discussion? Get a drill, hold it, and let it run anti-clockwise or clockwise. As long as it's done the way we say, you see the point. Even if it doesn't go the other way, you still produce plasma, but you have to make sure that in all your coils you follow the same thing.
Mr. Keshe.
Same thing as same direction.
Same
energy.
Mr. Keshe,
could you clarify something about the plasma?
It's the same energy.
Could you clarify something about the plasma? If we take up the physicality of the coil out of the topic for a moment and just look at the point of origin at the
speaking
of the halo. Oh, this is Emmanuel.
Ah, yes.
If we take the physicality of the copper wire out of the perspective, don't worry about the twist. Only look at the center of the halo itself, where the GANS ball is sitting. Is there a significance in how the ambient field of plasma travels around the actual ball in the center?
No, it's the same as the sun. Does it matter if the Earth is on the north side of the sun or the side of the sun, or if the Saturn is in the position? I think when
the rotation of the planets around the sun itself.
No, it doesn't. This is people, I say, most of the position comes from the ignorance of understanding. If this is the sun, and if this is the Earth, if the Earth is there or here, or if Jupiter or Saturn is here or here, the field of the plasma is dynamic, it's everywhere. This is irrelevant. It's irrelevant. The field, you take what you need. Please sit down. Come in. Sit on this end. Come over. We have our students, which we said they're going to be here on Thursday. They're just coming in. I will just spend a few minutes with them. So this condition of the plasma is absolutely irrelevant, because the field depends on what strength you want to use it. It's all in it. So it's totally, I always say, discussion is a very good point, because enlightens. Argument is those who are what I call attention seekers. They want to take energy to confirm their existence. Discuss. But those who start opposing and then doing everything else, tell them you were in the teaching yesterday, private teaching institute yesterday, what Caroline was teaching. A child comes, one attention, you just pay 2 second attention and they go. These stop wasting energy, discuss, but don't get into argument, I'm right, there is something wrong. Understand the totality of the plasma operation. Plasma is the love of God. It spreads equal in every direction. Does not matter where you sit, but it's like a river. It has its turbulence. It has its directional motion. You want to sit in the same direction, you flow with it. You want to go opposite to it, it shows its resistance. It's simple, absolutely simple. So
how do we determine that condition of whether
we depends what you want to create a condition of? Depends what you're expecting of the change. If I create opposition, or in a way, look, this shows if you are rotating this way and the field of your coil the other way, what's going to happen? Simply, you have interaction between the fields, you have a resistance. What is going to give you? Residual of different strength. What are you going to do with this? That's all it is. If he interacts, if you look at the plasma, if this is the plasma and interacts at this strength, you get this. But if you put your coil slightly in a different position, interacts at this, you get a different strength, different condition, different material. So what is the discussion? Is you who could extend the knowledge to understand what the interaction gives, not who's right or who's wrong.
So it doesn't matter about the twisting, it matters about the position and the strength of the plasma.
The twisting is the way this system is set up to produce certain things. If you follow the same thing in the same direction, it gives you a better result, better output, and it's maximization. That's all it is. You maximize your output. When it's very easy, you have a coil, you start from the drill in the opposite direction of the rotation, we call it the left-hand drive. You take it, thank you very much. If you take it the right hand, you still get the coil. You still get the extension of the, what do you call it, the field.
So how do we determine the position that we want to get in? So we want to go with the plasma.
You decide, you want a banana or you want orange? Thank you very much.
Yes, we have an ambient field of plasma. So how do we determine about different coil sizes and structures so that we can...
By experience, by experimenting.
So we just have to experiment, that's it.
Of course. Look, okay. I think you have to... you miss a big point. You miss the boat. You're swimming in the river going nowhere. Have you ever stood still, any of you? Look what you've done. You took a coil and you made 70 turn of it or 80 turn of it. You took the same coil, you made 150 turn of it. You put them inside each other, gravitational, magnetic. You took the same coil 10 times and you put a nanomaterial inside it. You called it a capacitor. You took the same coil, you put a wire in it, and you put another coil on top of it, and you put a matter inside it, you called it a battery, energy unit. Doesn't matter left or right, doesn't matter. It just by the number of turns, you change the potential in what you want to do. No science has been so simpler than this. Turn left it, right turn it, your battery still produces the same energy.
But Mr. Keshe, can we then use the potential of the wire to set...
That is, you can do whatever you like.
No? Can we use the potential of the winding itself to change the condition of the plasma in the center?
That's your decision. Depends what you use for the plasma. If you put two wires together, they burn. You nano-coated it. You nano-coated it, now you see it doesn't burn. It behaves different. Now you put GANS in between it, and now you see the energy. If any of you gets two nano-coated copper wire and put it together, it will show no performance. When you put a GANS on it, you introduce the energy source on it, then becomes a battery or whatever. It's you who decides. You want to put a GANS of CO2, you want to put a GANS of plutonium. Depends on what energy you expect from it, what you want to perform.
No, I mean about manipulating the free plasma itself.
This is your problem. You have to learn how you want to manipulate. You have to decide how you want to manipulate and what is the outcome. You don't know, test it. This is at the moment a free fall situation. You can just learn and come and teach us. I put copper nano-coated with zinc, I get a CO2. All of you are using it for different application, for the health and the rest. Because I set out in my understanding of the neurosystem to be connected with CO2 to create a copper, to create a carbon. I spent years perfecting the technology from what I call a nano-coated copper and zinc. And now you lot come and do it like nothing, and then you say, what is it? You do what I did. Broaden the spectrum of the knowledge. You shouldn't be a spoon feed. What does it do? You all like to be fed, spoon fed, it's finished. Now you have to become parents and spoon feed the others.
by experimenting. It's becoming too narrow, and that's the purpose of these teachings. Open up the horizon. It's becoming like a funnel. You're all looking down the same hole, seeing the same thing. You all have become professors in nanomaterial. And exactly what we didn't wanted, we wanted you all to be kindergarten children, to see everything, to open up. The problem with this technology so rapidly, because you see results, has created again a bunch of narrow-minded people looking at the end of the same tunnel. And this was exactly what we didn't want to get. Those are looking outside, in a broader spectrum, they are seeing new things. And now, what does this do? What does that do? What is this? Test it. Bring back the knowledge. We gave you the ground to work. Build on it. Not to come and spoon. What will happen? If I do a back twisted, if I do a right twisted, if I do clockwise, if I do anti-clockwise, what happened? You test and see what you get. Or you have come here for the freebies. I take the knowledge and I go and copy and see what it gets. And this is exactly what I'm trying to discourage. And what I'm trying to do is please create new parameters, new dimensions, and teach us. Who've done a wire? I'm literally getting to the point in the past 3 weeks, instead of enjoying the beauty of the knowledge, bunch of narrow-minded people have made the winding the whole core of the studies. So
yep,
wrong place. Go home, and when you mature, come back and learn.
So you are telling us to experiment with the manipulating the strength of the plasma in the fields itself, not to worry about anything else.
That is you. It shows you why you ask me. You go and find a way into a strengthening. I've shown it so many times how you strengthen the plasma if you want a stronger plasma. We call it a composite plasma, composite gas. So it means you don't listen, you just want to follow something just to prove the existence. This is not that, it's all in the teaching. Every composite, every strength, you've been taught in the teachings how you calculate, how you can increase the total strength of the plasma. This situation, this story with the turns and the left and right, is nothing but those who, okay, at the beginning, we made it very clear, now follow the same thing. If you don't understand, you like to be in that path, follow it, you will get to it. You don't follow it, it creates a different condition, different problems, but it's not a problem, it's a solution for another thing which we haven't understood. Very simple. You have two plasmas, they interact with each other, north to south, south to north, and then you just change the strength and find different positions, different properties, different interactions. If you have two, you call them nano-coated, you call them GANS-coated. If you increase, you reduce the strength, the interaction is at higher order, you get a stronger residue. If this moves here with the same strength, is the interaction is at the lower strength, so you get a different material. ABC, no problem, you don't have a Z, you don't have a Y. Nothing has been simpler than a plasma, except those who want to confirm their existence through lack of their own understanding. I told you from the beginning, from the first teaching, people will take from this technology according to their intelligence. You cannot blame them. This is what they understand, and that's how they can confirm their existence. So, how does the plasma do? Can I have a stronger plasma? Can I turn it clockwise? Can I turn it anti-clockwise? What does a clockwise inside the anti-clockwise mean? Very simply, interaction of the field, residual, and everything else. Simply. It's two magnets. You put two magnets face to face, right polarity, they attract, right polarity, they repel. It depends what is the right polarity to you, and what is the wrong polarity to the others. Depends where you stand in position, in the structure, and there's no technology has been easier than this, and I don't understand why a very few people have made the coil turning such a huge dilemma.
Mr. Keshe,
to unify it. And if it's a problem, Very easy. You go to a shop, you buy a drill, you put a stick in it, and you plug it on the reverse. Get the wire in front of you and let it roll. This is the winding you need. It's never been cleaner. Do you want me to send you a video instruction, or would you like me to buy the drill for you, which has a reversal on it? Never been as easy as this. There it is. You go to the shop, you buy a wire, and get yourself a drill. What did I do with the drill? I took it back downstairs again. It's not ignorance. It's just people who start this, somehow they want to confirm their existence. And there is a time for it, but not enough to spend the rest of the time unwinding. This is a wire. I don't think it's very hard. It doesn't need a man with a PhD from CERN. You put your drill on, you don't have a drill, you get yourself a screwdriver, hold it, and all you do, turn the screwdriver backwards. There we are. If this is very difficult, God help us, you're in the wrong place. We go back to kindergarten. Any other questions, or shall we call it the lunchtime?
I think that's definitely lunch.
Thank you very much indeed.
Enjoy your maple syrup.
And we'll see you in another hour now.
Very good.
For those that are on the teachings, I think we'll start in an hour. So we'll do in an hour.
Now?
It is 2:30.
2:30 my time?
Yep.
No, it's 1:30.
1:30, sorry, 1:30.
1:30. We never start at 2:30. We start at 3 o'clock. Yeah, we never done in 1 hour on
Thursday. Okay, so I'll see you at 4 o'clock.
And we see you at 3 o'clock, 3 to 5 is a good time. And this afternoon session is again on the free plasma, and the teaching is by Caroline. So it should be easy to understand. Thank you very much. Thanks for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Keshe.
Thank you, Lee.
And that's the end of the 87th Knowledge Seekers Workshop of the Keshe Foundation Spaceship Institute. And once again, as many times before, thank you, everybody, for attending. Okay, we'll end the live stream and...